lost somebody? Why does it look like we lost somebody? This is a game. Play the way it's supposed to be played. They are missing all their shots. Don't make no stupid fouls. We are playing zone. You know how to play the zone. We practiced this enough times. Okay?
When you two drive, when you punch gaps, look for the kick out.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to knock him down. Okay? And look for the kick out. Flash outside.
Okay, that means 1, 2, 3. Listen. Listen. This is what we're going to do. High pick and roll. Yeah, see? Go to both corners. Start lighting out. Listen. Lights out.
Yeah, listen up. When we ran, we had to do. Why are we letting them set?
All of you guys are not three.
2, 3. Recording, get to level interview, go ahead.
You know, this whole process started as a dream.
Mm.
And, you know, a dream is still a dream until you make it a reality. Somali American. I was born in Mogadishu, Somalia. While I was young, there was a big civil war that took place in 1991. I fled with my family and siblings to a neighboring country called Kenya. We stayed there for a few years. Then through a sponsorship program, we immigrated to the United States. Our first stop was in Baltimore, Maryland. In 1995. We stayed there for 3 months. Then we moved to the city of Minneapolis, Minnesota. I've lived here since January 1996. I pretty much spent most of my life here. I went to middle school, high school, and I finished my college studies in Minneapolis, Minnesota as well. You know, my father is a former soccer player. You know, soccer was the first sport I ever picked up. I played in high school. I considered myself to be a good soccer player until I came into contact with basketball. I can honestly say the first time I've seen, you know, guys my age play basketball, I fell in love with the game. So, you know, it really made me interested on learning how to play. So every day I'll try to go like to a basketball court, you know, play after school, and eventually I'll end up playing for my high school. During that time, you know, most of Somali people lived in the southern part of Minneapolis. What I remember is, you know, there were not too many soccer fields in Minneapolis because generally, you know, this city is a very cold city. So it was cold pretty much about, you know, 8 to 9 months a year. But there was, you know, a lot of basketball, indoor basketball gyms. So me and my friends, you know, after school, we would go out to different gyms, you know, to play against, you know, American kids. But what I remember is, you know, we were not welcomed with open arms because we were a new community and, you know, there was a language barrier. So kids used to give us hard time. Then, you know, I found out that in Riverside Cedar neighborhood, where there's a little bit more Somali families living there, there was a, you know, a community center with a basketball gym, indoor basketball gym. So every day me and my friends will make the trip. Sometimes we'll walk for a long time, or if we had bus fare, we'll take a bus, we'll go there. And that's where we, you know, us Somali kids felt safe, and we played amongst our peers.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. My name is Abdulrahman Mukhtar. I am the youth program manager at the Brian Colley Center. The Brian Colley Center is a community center that locates at City Riverside neighborhood, whereas many people from the East African community especially the Somali community as they know as Cedar. I also live in the neighborhood. I've been doing this work last 15 years. For me, this is a lifetime commitment. My passion of working with young people, connecting resources and opportunities to young people, and also helping young people in general. That's a passion of mine. And the work that you're doing, especially sports-related opportunities for young adults from the East African community or from the Somali community, is highly needed. As a program manager, a lot of times when people think about after-school programs, or as we know, or as we call out-of-school time programs, the most important thing is structure and, you know, how consistent young people get the opportunities that they need. Whether it's homework help or open gym activities, the way you structure and how often you provide these activities or opportunities, they make a huge difference. So one of the challenges that we see with our youth, especially, you know, young adults, most of the after-school programs or the programs that help young people, they help young people when they are the age of 5 to 18 years old, or kindergarten, K to 12, or the 12th grade. Once young people age out from that program, most of the programs really kick them out.
After graduating from high school, I went off to college. While I was attending college, I still played basketball. Then, you know, that's when basketball really became a passion for me. I played for different organizations, for different coaches. The good memories I have about those organizations is I got to meet some, you know, good friends, people that love the game just like I did. You know, one thing that I will come to dislike is, you know, the organizations I played for, I felt like, you know, they did not really have a good vision for the welfare of the players, or, you know, they didn't have the players' best interest in hand. To them, it was just about, you know, just playing basketball. And, you know, basketball is supposed to build a player's character. And the teams I played for at the time were not really focusing on that. So one day, you know, in 2004, I sat down with some of my friends. We put ideas together, and you know, that's how we came about establishing Somali Dream Team.
I joined Dream Team in 2004, and one of my friends at the time, Ahmed, invited me to the team. And that's how I joined Dream Team. What I saw that was different from the other teams in Dream Team was Dream Team had a strong strong chemistry and a strong partnership. And also, I saw brotherhood in the team, where I did not see in the other teams. And the players were very disciplined. And the team was a team that was very organized.
This basketball structure, giving young people a passion that they have, which is mostly sports. If you tell any young person what sports you want to play, they'll tell you basketball or soccer. Basketball is number one. So if you give them that structure, and then you give them adults, mentors that can build relationship with them, that can coach them, that can give them that valuable advice that they need in life, but also that can give them that tough love of telling them, you don't want to play open basketball gym every day. You don't want to come and play one-on-one basketball game. You don't need to continue to do the same thing again and again. If you have the skills, which most of our young people have, at some point you have to really also put the hard work of coming and practicing, and then getting into a team, into a structure, and then that can lead to a more meaningful experience, which is a lot of the issues that young people are going or dealing with nowadays are identity crisis. But being in a basketball team, it gives you an identity. Your team is your family. It gives you a sense of ownership. It gives you an identity, especially with the work that your coaches are doing.
What I think about the Dream Team, I think it's people that care for what's happening with our youth and actually taking the leadership role to engage in their lives, to give them some form of an outlet to become professional in their life, to become an adult and understand that the circumstances that, that life presents, and also give the kids guidance. I think that's one of the things, and hope. A lot of things that's happening right now around our community, but also everywhere in the media, is, you know, the whole situation of terrorism, Islam situation. So there's a lot of different messages that's being given to the youth. And I feel that this program is actually helpful for the kids because, you know, let's just say they are really good at what they do in sports. And this can actually enhance their, you know, lifestyles in a way that is physical, but also mental. And that can actually encourage them to become responsible for other kids in their community.
I think the two major dilemmas that the East African youth are going through, specifically in the Twin Cities or in the state of Minnesota, is that they are disconnected from the resources out there for them. And I don't think, for my personal and professional opinion, that the society is giving them the resources that they need. So my point is that there is a huge lack of resource in the communities that most East African live, such as, you know, programs that can help them to focus on positivities. If it is in a center, for example, we have the largest youth in Minneapolis live in a very dense area called the City Riverside, for example. You have one center, and being someone who worked in their area and have a strong tie with that community, I don't think that is enough. I think we need resources so that those scholars or those young men and women can take advantage of, and I don't think that we have that. That's number one.
But also, nowadays, we always talk about young people who went back to Somalia to join Al-Shabaab or ISIS. But we don't talk about a lot all the young people who went back to Somalia to represent their native country. Whether they play for a national basketball team, national soccer team, or whether they went back to work for the government.
Productive things. They are part of the government. They are part of rebuilding housing, they're part of businesses, they give other people jobs. But I don't think that's talked about in the media.
In 2014, on our 10th year anniversary, the same guys that started Somali Dream Team, we came together and, you know, we were just having a conversation about how we wanted to take the team to play in higher competition. So actually, I'm the one that came up with the idea of, you know, having our team participate in international competitions. They loved it, and they welcomed the idea. And, you know, that's how we came about getting in touch with the committee of the Eastern Central Africa Basketball League. As soon as we received our official invitation, I knew right away our work was cut out. I contacted two of my best friends and my former teammates right away. Hakim Dalmar, known as AU, and Jama Shine, known as JJ.
We came together, we immediately put a plan together because we didn't have a lot of time to waste. We put the ideas together and we decided to put a team that consisted of players from all over North America. We contacted a few good players that played in Division I basketball at the time, and at that time it was hard to get a lot of stuff going because they were still going to school and some of them had exams, so we didn't want to distract them or anything like that. So, you know, we took it easy. For the first 3 weeks, I will say, you know, I sat down with a lot of community members, including community leaders, you know, our ex-prime minister being one of them, Mr. Abdulwali Sheikh Ahmed, you know, just to get an input of what they think. And, you know, a lot of people that I've met, you know, were skeptical in the beginning. Because they saw us as a group of young guys who have never done this type of work before.
Actually, we are meeting the former Prime Minister of Somalia, Mr. Abdulwali Sheikh Ahmed. So we're gonna get to know each other, and you know, we're gonna share information with each other. So I'm looking forward to this meeting.
You know, there's few that really, really welcomed the idea, including my friend Wilwal. I just happened to tell him about what I was trying to do at the time. Before I even, you know, finished my sentence, he really smiled, and and this is a guy that's a filmmaker, and he was really, really, you know, in love with the idea of us, you know, doing this, and he's the first guy that actually told me that we are doing something historic. Me going through, you know, what I was going through, struggling, you know, trying to get a lot of people involved, you know, it was something humbling for me to hear at the time. That's just what I needed to motivate me even more. You know, I called a good friend of mine named Muhammad Khalif, who lives in Toronto, Canada. Initially, I wanted him to be part of the team because he had a lot of experience playing international basketball and representing Somalia as well. Unfortunately, he was injured at the time. He proposed the idea of you know, hooking me up with some other players who were actually in their prime at the time. And once he gave me their names, I was really excited because these are guys that I followed as far as their career goes. Yeah, just to name a few, one of them is Yusuf Ali, who will become, you know, our leader and our point guard and our team captain. Mohamed Khalif introduced me to a friend of his named Mohamed Firin. As soon as we spoke over the phone, we just hit it from there.
So I got connected to Ahmed Yassin through a friend of mine. His name is Mohamed Khalif. And when I first spoke to Ahmed Yassin, he was actually trying to make his own team. And we spoke for a bit, and then that's how we decided to actually form an alliance and have one team that represented all of North America.
The guy actually saw everything from the same angle as we were seeing. He started working with us. He introduced me to some of the players that would eventually play for the team. Hamid Frin later introduced me to a guy named Abdelrashid Bakken, who has done a lot of work in the Somali community. Mohamed Firin also introduced me to a guy by the name of Ahmed Jama, better known as AJ. AJ became our coordinator, and he brought a lot of expertise to the table. This is a guy that you know, would eventually become the bridge, communication bridge between the coaching staff and the players. Now that we got the management out of the way, the management consisted in Minnesota. It was myself, Abdelhakim AU, and JJ. Then in Toronto, it was Mohamed Firin, AJ, and Abdelrashid Bakken. Then we moved on to the next phase, which was to select players. We set up a criteria of who we wanted as a player for our team. We decided to put a 12-man roster on our team. The six players we chose from the United States were Rabil Noor from Columbus, Ohio, Abdelkarim Noor from Atlanta, Georgia, Mohamed Mohamed from Minneapolis, Minnesota, Yassin Omar from Mankato, Minnesota, Abdul Ahmed from Bakersfield, California, and last but not least, Mohamed Olo from Seattle, Washington. Then it was the turn for the Toronto guys to pick six players based on their skill, discipline, character, and personality. The six players we chose from Toronto, Canada were Mohamed Rage, Yusuf Ali, Abbas, Ahmed Melo, Ayub Mohamed, Mohamed Maslah. On the invitation letter we received, there were tournament rules and requirements that we had to obey. One of them being that we had to come over there with a professional referee. There's not really a lot of Somali professional referees. We found out that there was a professional Somali referee living in Germany. I ended up contacting him.
Go.
After we completed the roster, our next step was to come together in the city of Minneapolis to start practicing. There was issues that came up right away. The biggest issue was all the players were still attending college. So that made us wait until college ended. The second biggest issue was, you know, it was costly. It didn't make sense to bring all the players here because we didn't have the big financial backing. So we couldn't afford to bring all the players together in the city. So we all agreed that we were all going to meet in Dar es-Salam, Tanzania.
So these young people who are organizing, no one is really paying them to do this. They are paying their own money. The coaches are struggling to get tickets or a hotel these young people can stay. Sometimes I know they struggle to find a gym these teams can play or practice.
Bro, it's like we ran away from our country because of war. We got Somali youth killing one another over here. Oh, that's just sad, man.
Is that one of the reasons you guys are organizing this?
It's just, yeah, one of the reasons, because we are trying to show a different side of Somali youth, because all the Somali youth are not all about violence and doing bad stuff. Actually, there's more youth that do good than bad. So we are just trying to show everybody that we can come together and accomplish something as a team. Yasin.
Yeah.
Ivor. Bro, I left food on the at the door. I had to run. I gotta go pick up my son, man.
Okay.
Yeah, get it. Sports
okay,
ayal. Hey, AJ, Mr. Ahmed Chama, he's our coordinator.
Okay, from
he's from Toronto, Ontario, Canada. Yeah. That guy, I haven't met him in person. We just spoke over the phone a few times. The referee guy, I just spoke with him for the first time today. I haven't met Bucket in person. I've met most of the players that's come from Toronto throughout the years. Yeah, that's it. That's that. And I know pretty much everybody that's leaving out of the United States. So, Marka AJ, I hope to meet him inshallah next Saturday when we get there. And he's always on point. Okay? So, we are all in it for the right reasons. That's why. Abu, tell him your name.
Hanad.
Hanad who?
Hanad Yasin.
Are you forgetting the middle name?
Ahmed.
Hanad Ahmed Yasin. This is my twin, this is my heart. Anything I do it for him. Yeah, the future is the basketball, right?
Kids are looking up to people that are in power right now. And I think that has to keep going, And we have to set role models for the kids in some ways.
It kept me away from the negative of life, whether it's drugs, whether it's violence or gangs, or I never had a time for that. When I had free time and when I wanted to have entertainment, I would go to my team and we would practice and we go to the gym and we were always have games coming up and we always have schedules. So I didn't have time to think about something else. I already had a set schedule with my team, which I was enjoying because we were having so much fun and we were building so much brotherhood.
Who is not only helping youth here in Minnesota, here in Minneapolis, but taking those youth globally or taking them back home in Africa and making them participate in basketball activities is necessary. Activities that our youth really need. Programs like that will really help the youth to be fundamentally engaged in the society and to do positive things.
It's just like, I mean, position kicker, there's more than 100 kids probably calling Ahmed, you know what I mean? Wanting to play in my position, wanting to play in, and there's only 10, 12 spots. So to get that call up, it's something that, you know what I mean, I've always wanted, you know what I mean? I did it back in 2008 when we went to Morocco, and it was alhamdulillah, it was a blessing, you know what I mean? I look back on that opportunity every day, you know what I mean? And even now, the college that I was just going to, there was one kid from Egypt that we played against back in 08, you know what I mean? So it's crazy.
1 week before our departure, I received a call from Abdul Ahmed, who told me that he couldn't make it to the trip because he was graduating from college. And so he had to attend his graduation. So it wouldn't be possible for him to make it. So that cut our six people from United States short. So there was only five players left that could have gone with me. We ended up leaving out of Minneapolis-St. Paul Airport on the 22nd of May. Our connection flight was in Amsterdam. That's where I hooked up with Will Wall, who left Minneapolis City a few hours after us.
سفر بالك تجيا إيه صعب تغيره صنع الله إنه ولا السجاي.
Once we landed in Tanzania, we got interviewed by the immigration on the reason why we were visiting Tanzania. We showed him our invitation and we told him that we were participating in the 17th annual Eastern Central Africa basketball tournament. They didn't really believe us, so they asked us if we had any contacts, and we gave him the contacts. This was around 11 p.m. at night, so they tried to call the president and the vice president of the tournament. Both of them weren't picking up. We ended up spending almost 2 hours there trying to get a hold of somebody that will explain to the immigration of Tanzania that we were there for a good reason. Once we finally got released by Tanzanian immigration, we felt relief. That's when reality hit me. We came out of the airport and I could smell the African scent. Most of our players have never been to Africa, and you know, the weather felt different. We felt that we were finally home. You know, we kind of were nervous about because we always hear that you know, there's mosquitoes in Africa, so we started spraying ourselves in case we were bit by mosquitoes.
So Somalis in Tanzania have, as you say, most of the Somalis they're football lovers, so the youth play a lot of football activities. They also play basketball. So sports in Tanzania is Somalis in Tanzania is a very important tool, and it's one of the tools that I personally like, and I believe that it's a foundation of our unity. It brings a strong foundation of unity within the youth community.
Once we got out of the airport, we were welcomed by a guy named Peter. who took us to our hotel. There we got visitation from an official from the tournament. Once we finally made it to our hotel, we were just waiting on the other half of the team, which were coming from the Canada, and they were coming a day after. Once the whole team made it, you know, we made some phone calls because we wanted to get some practices done. We only had 3 days before the tournament started. You know, Tanzania doesn't have a lot of basketball facilities. We found out that there's an outside basketball court, you know, about 20 minutes from where we stayed. Once we went there, you know, there was a bunch of other guys that were playing pickup basketball, and we only had 2 days to practice. So we asked the guys that were playing pickup basketball if they could let us use the court for, you know, a little while to get some practices done. Thankfully, they let us do that, but they only gave us an hour. That's when I was introduced to my assistant coach named Mohamed Hassan, also known as Mohamed Raf, who has been a coach for a long time as an assistant coach in one of the colleges in Toronto. I got to know him. We had a decent conversation.
Okay, inshallah, really, really, ideas you have, Mark.
Yeah.
I wanted to look at come together before every practice or before every game.
Yes.
Basketball, you know, there's a lot that goes into basketball. It's just not offensive, defensive. Inbound plays that you.
Yeah.
How about the
yeah.
Isolation plays that you. This guy, I know he's not an isolation player. Yeah. The mantra Habib only got into his brain and his vision to everybody, and sometimes he has to go. Because he said he has the capability of scoring any time. And so I'll play whatever ideas you have, man.
If you look at it now, you know, he brought guys with him from the US that I would never have met if it wasn't for him. You know, and I seen the guys. When they came, they have the same mindset as the guys I came with. So it shows you right there that, you know, me and him are meshing beautifully. And you know, I'm hoping that our relationship even grows a lot more, you know, throughout this basketball programs and the things that he does back home in Minnesota and things I do in Toronto. I hope that, you know, we can carry it on and do greater things.
From the get-go, I had to let every player know that there's no I in a team. We play as a team, we win as a team, and we lose as a team.
We're going to play a lot of man-to-man, we're going to play a lot of zone, a lot of different things. Some of you guys like zone better, some of you guys like man better. From now on, I want you guys to know, it's not about the individual, it's about what the coach tells you and you playing for the team. So to me, it doesn't really matter whether you like to play man-to-man. When it's time to play man-to-man, you're going to play man-to-man and you're going to respect the game and you're going to do what you have to do to stick your man.
Yes, coach.
When it comes to playing zone defense, I could care less about how much you like or dislike zone defense. When it's time to play zone, it's time to play zone. So I have respect for all of you guys, and I wish all of you guys feel the same way about me. It's nothing personal. Me and Raf are here to coach the team. That means we have to play our role. Just like you are playing your role, Anakin, we have to play our role. So I want you guys, not only are we requesting, but we are demanding that you respect what we do here. Because if you don't, I think you came to waste your time over here. Again, as much as I respect each one of you guys, we are supposed to be a team. A team should be like a family. Marka, this is basketball, and this is something basic. Basketball is not hard. All you have to do is listen to what your coaches tell you, listen to what your players are telling you. All you have to do is just execute plays.
Easy.
Nobody's... Okay, I have a question for everyone. Who wants to win an MVP? Because I'll gladly give it to you right now. But you're going to spend the rest of the time on the bench. You want to be the scoring leader of this team? This is not the team for you. You want to be respected? Respect the game itself. That's where the respect comes from. When you respect the game for what it is, that's when you get respect from everybody else. I see you disrespecting the game. That means like you are, I'll take it as if you are disrespecting me or you're disrespecting Raf or you're disrespecting the next guy. Marka, please, we take basketball very serious. I pay attention to detail. I could care less if you shoot 10 air balls. As long as the shot is there, okay? You have the right to take a shot. But please, somebody force him. You don't have to prove it to us here that you are good. You guys are the best Somali basketball players in the world right now. Believe it or not. I know more about some of you guys that you don't even know about yourself. But that's for us to talk about some other time. I want everybody on this side of the court. I'm gonna demonstrate maybe one time, not more than two times. So you better be on your A game.
After all the teams came from different countries, the whole city felt like it was in the Olympics. On the newspapers, on the TV news, everybody will talk about the talent level and how big this tournament was going to be. They were, you know, predicting who they thought was going to win the championship. A lot of people were really impressed by a team from North America.
يعني الصومالي ده أول واحد له أركا يعني زي ده بس كده بيجي ده عيار أبو دين وإحنا عاصي مثلا لكن حد وحكة يعني جودي وحكة مسكوبة وحي أمسيهم إلى أفريقيا كم صدوم عيار توي ده يا أي أمسيهم هم وحيدين أنا كان ما قد ترى ونمن حلو قد
We met with the guys from the U.S. first day here in the hotel. It was nice to meet them. First time I met all these guys, you know, and Ahmed Yassin, first time I met him. So we only had two practices to get to know each other, but I think everyone tried their best.
And so today was the second day of practice. Today we had a four-hour practice at one of the local basketball courts. It's our final day of practice, and we have a game tomorrow, which is Wednesday, at 5 o'clock against the team from Dar Es-Salam. I cannot predict the outcome, but this is what I know we will bring to the table. We will bring a group of guys that have bonded, even though they had a short time, you know, to practice with each other. But I'm confident that the results will be determined by how much hard work we put in on the floor, and I'm very comfortable. Even though we have a lot of players on our team, it's better to have more players than less players. And we have a total of 11 players that have signed up for this tournament. It's going to be a challenge, dealing with all 11 players, given that they are all very talented, and you are dealing with 11 different personalities. So managing that itself, it's difficult for a lot of people, and but I look forward to that challenge because. When one thing goes wrong, a lot of other things can go wrong. So, I'm praying that nothing goes wrong for us. As far as the team we are playing against, I haven't really got a chance to watch their tape because of the, timing and everything moving fast, and we had so many other things to do. But I am hoping that if we jump on them from the get-go, hopefully we'll get the win. And it's just that I feel as though, we are not only representing one city. We feel like we are representing a whole country. And that's something big. That's where our biggest motivation comes from.
Because the way they were coaching,
So
So throughout the week, we've been practicing, and basically we've just been running some sets, you know, kind of getting a chemistry going. And alhamdulillah, we have a good team chemistry, and we have a lot of unselfish guys. We have guys that are willing to share the basketball. And for us to win today, it means a lot, because that's what we're here to do. We're here to win. And for the first game, you just gotta play calm and play as a team, play as a unit. Because if you can't win the first game, you're gonna have problems on throughout the tournament. Our goal is to be unselfish, to execute our plays, and to win.
Yesterday we went over zone offense, went over our principles on the motion, principles on the 14 play, who we want the ball to go to, who you want to space the court. So yesterday we got a lot done. Alhamdulillah.
Coaching a team of this amount of players, it's not easy for anyone, especially with the limited time we had to practice. And I hope each one of you understands the challenge that we are faced with, me and my brother Muhammad Raf. And it's not an easy thing. I know each of you guys have sacrificed a lot, and there's a lot of things you left back home that you could have been doing right now. So that, you know, that I already know the commitment you have made. And you know, a lot of things are easier said than done. When you are faced with reality, you know, you never know how that person is going to react. And I know most of you guys personally, and I have 100% belief in you that, you know, you'll do what you need to do when you are out there. But this is a guideline for between us, an agreement between coaching staff and the players, that you know, it'll make everybody's job easier. Okay, I don't know if you guys remember, but the first practice we had, I kept repeating the word respect. If there's no respect between us, there's literally nothing between us. When I say respect, it doesn't mean you only respect the coaching staff. We respect you right back. Sometimes we respect you more than you respect us. Marka, I want the respect to be mutual. I want you guys to respect each other, you know, as individuals. I know you guys are already doing that, but I want you to sign that, proving that you will abide by this guideline. Okay, we are here to win. And anybody that's standing in our way, you know, we have to put them to the side. Just because you mess up one time doesn't mean what's the galena, you know? People make mistakes, I make mistakes. Okay? But every disciplinary action should have, you know, a different level. Marka, I'm not called time can respect galena. We don't have too much time, and I know other has to speak, so I want each one of you guys to sign.
Okay, what do you mean? Anda waktu putih, kami asing, mana tak kelam dengan soro, dia hatta, illa ada wad muka. Selama kelam mana hanya rasa, kewe ini sebab tu handal kerana yo, kalau ni mana, dia dah di sini semula. Mana awak awal, alhamdulillah, masya Allah, everybody say masya Allah.
Masya Allah.
Mana kami asing ada bawa mahdi kerana dia, malam tak selama hari ini, malam dengan soro, kau lah hari ini, anak, mana aku am kerana, ini aku dah syakirno. سيان قول وقارنا في مانتان سبورة شغنو هذا الكيسة هي شغين تيسة مروكي قال قصر بالوضي مروكا قرن مدى سمالي آت بوصر ريسا الحمد لله رب العالمين.
Today we'll be playing Dar es-Salam, the hosting team of this tournament, inshallah. Our game is at 5 o'clock, inshallah ta'ala. We practice very well. And we are ready to play this game, inshallah. We are here to bring the trophy home, inshallah, and hold it down for Somalia, inshallah.
Shaqai, tulwa alaki.
supposed to be at 6 o'clock. It didn't start until almost 8 p.m. When we got there an hour early, we started, you know, shooting around. We did some drills. We got warmed up, we stretched out. And right before the opening ceremony, you know, the lights went out. You know, our players are not used to that. And you know, I told them, TIA, this is Africa. Expect anything. And the lights were out for more than an hour and a half.
You know, our first game, we ended up playing against a team from the Dar Es-Salam called Dar City, who were a hometown favorite. You know, this team was a very good team that have been together for a long time. They have participated in a lot of different tournaments. And our team was just a team, you know, that met each other for the first time about 4 days before the first game. We struggled.
Beautiful, man. Tell them, man. You can got me. Yeah. we're trying to block a shot that a man can't even shoot. They can't hit shots right now. They're tired. Come on, guys, make up your mind. Know what you're doing.
Nimependa kuona baada ya hapa game kati ya Mbeya City na Mbeya mabingwa wa mchezo. Huu wamepiga tawe hatari sana kwa wanae. Huu mchezo umekwisha, imerudi kuwa 9 points na kusababisha another rise and turn over. Mara mwisho hii timu mbili zimekutana Dar City zikipigwa takriban point 10. Sasa hivi naona zimebaki sekunde chache. Dar City kwa kupima kwa point 9. Ikiwa na maana kwamba wameimprove kwa point 1 kutoka mazungumzo. Any type of improvement is going to improve.
You know, the Tanzanian team had a lot of support behind them because they are, you know, the hometown team. I would say 95% of people that were watching the game were all from here, so they were rooting for their team. And, you know, as a local team, you know, they got all the support from their fans. We had a few, you know, Somali people that, you know, came over there. Mostly were the team, you know, that came from Mogadishu. I just want to thank them for supporting us. And there were other, you know, few people that live in this area who also came through and, you know, showed us a lot of love. But overall, they had way more fans than us. And I wish as the games continue that our fans will just, you know, will get bigger. And because support is very important in this game. When you have the crowd behind you, you don't know, you know, it takes you, you know, it gives you that edge. Because when, you know, Tanzania was down about, you know, double digits, you know, the crowd willed them back. Because they'll make a basket and they'll start celebrating. And, you know, the crowd was the reason why they got their momentum going. But at the end, you know, we fought hard as well. I believed in my guys from day one. I still believe in them. Some games you're not gonna get everything you want to get done, but you know, as long as you have a you know, strong heart and you give a good fight, you know, that's how, you know, the result is determined. That's one of our strengths. Our players listen, they respond every time, and I hope, you know, tomorrow we'll have a better day, given that, you know, we were, you know, rusty from the first game.
She said, I'm my lover, you belong to me.
If you guys hear any motion, this is
the pick up the ball, guys. Pick up the ball. Who has that guy? Who has that guy right now? Who has that guy? Who has it? See, nobody. No,
I have it.
You have it? Huh? Come on. Don't let him do that again. I don't
want to
hear this.
Hey, you guys want to go home, man? You guys
want to
go home?
Come on. Angelidona, yanga tiyo wada teshi wasa mendona. Ajerenu wagu, sada shwagu. Farhadenu wagu, nabaduna wagu. Rajadenu wagu, sada shwagu. Farhadenu wagu, nabaduna wagu. Kuwa ilmi barte, wanka shahena. Kuwa jahil kahna, wakata shahena. Waka hurta gena, kuwa dulmi wadana, woku dulena. Daga fiyo dhaka shida wanu demihena. Dugo diyo ulumo, wala tashahena. Ola diyo qabyalit, waka foga hena. Dattiyo dalka wanu demahena. Rajaden wagu, sadash wagu. Farhaden wagu, nabaduna wagu. Rajaden wagu, sadash wagu. Kani burbure diplo disaya qaxootiyo baraka diplo dejina qaxdil iyo bob walaga gudbaya nabada subayne wayno dhalate ala kani burbugan calanku ka muuqda dowlad rasmiyahna maanta waynu helne jaali iyo ku meel gaad walaga gudbay taas waxay noo tahay farxad weyn rajadan waagu saadash waagu farxadan waagu nabaduna waagu Rajaden wagul, sadash wagul, farhaden wagul, nabaduna wagul. Rajaden wagul, sadash wagul, farhaden wagul, nabaduna wagul. Rajaden wagul, sadash wagul, farhaden wagul, nabaduna wagul.
We shall be number one. We will definitely take the cup. I know our youth that who have come, they have done a great job. We have a lot of appreciations for them. And playing around with many cities within the East African and the African community, we believe that they have learned the trade of the game.
You know, and the media went, you know, ballistic. Everybody was saying, how can a team from Somalia beat the capital city? What they don't understand is that these players are talented players. So their mind was focusing on Somalia, who's had a war the last 25 years. How come a team from Somalia can beat the Dar Es-Salam? You know, but I think that's basically misunderstanding, because they've actually underestimated the team.
Okay, so one game goes straight to the post. One game goes straight pick and roll. One game can go straight shooting. One game can do straight anything we want, we can do. So with us, we're a special team because our coaches that give us the ability to play free basketball.
After we beat Mbeya, we had a day off where we took a break from all basketball activities. You know, being in this kind of situation where you are constantly, you know, fighting for every possession takes a toll on the body. So we definitely needed that break to get away from all that, you know, attention and all that negative stuff. That day we went to White Sand Beach, a very beautiful beach that is. We went sightseeing and it was a relaxing day for us.
Today at 6 p.m. we are about to play our semifinal game, and we are facing another team from Tanzania called Dar City, and it's a semifinal game, and it's a very important game for us because this is an elimination game. If we do not win this game, we will not get a chance to play the finals. This past week we've played multiple different teams, and you know, as each game, as we played each game, you know, I feel as though we made a lot of progress. Given that we haven't had a, you know, much time to practice, but the progresses we made, I feel like each player grew.
Nice! Nice! Oh. Guys,
You won.
Right after the game ended, we started celebrating, but I had to make sure that celebration was brief. We just didn't want to settle for winning the semifinal game. We came here for something bigger than that. We came here to be number one, not to just make it to the final game. I gathered up my team once again, and I had to let them know that it wasn't time for celebration yet. We still had one more game to go. I reminded them to be humble, that we were representing our people that were scattered all over the globe, our people that were dying in the seas. That's when it got really emotional for me, and I normally don't cry, but I had to wipe the tears from my eye.
Let's go.
Some of the calls were suspect, so I started challenging all the suspicious calls, because I didn't think it was fair to our team, where we'll get fouled hard and no referee will call it for us. But when we sometimes don't even foul, they'll call a foul on us. And I had to walk to the scoreboard a couple of times to give my peace and let them know that some of the times the referees were not being fair. And the most shocking thing to me was when I caught a referee having a conversation when one of our staff members while the game was going on. So I told the referee, why are you talking to our staff members? Why don't you focus on the game? And he looked at me dead in the eye and told me, if that guy doesn't sit down, I will kill him.
No, it's okay. No, we have a camera.
Hey, there's no problem.
No, listen.
That is the problem.
How can he say I'll kill you? How can he tell me I'll kill you?
You cannot kill him.
Who told you?
No,
there is a camera.
We got him.
I said what? He said I will kill him. You got referees talking to players while the game is going on.
For a referee to say such words, that was very offensive to me. So I had to let them know. The game got stopped after a discussion with the president of the tournament. They assured me that it wasn't going to happen again.
After the semi-final games, we had a meeting. Our committee, we sit down. We talked about the tournament, things that went wrong, things that went well. We highlighted the referees, because the biggest problem is that we want each city who come to this competition to have their own referee. That's why we say that if you don't have a referee, you have to pay a penalty. So the reason is that if you had, you know, Cairo didn't bring a referee, you know, we had other cities don't actually bring the referees. So basically we have short of referees. So some cases you will see the Tanzanian referee, you know, they actually, you know, have extra bodies. So that's why we had a Tanzanian referee on our semi-finals. After the first half, we, you know, our person talked to the committee. I said, look, this game does actually look, you know, good because the referees from Tanzania, you know, it looks like they're supporting their team in Dar Es-Salam. So, and this competition, you know, is live on televisions. People from Africa, FIBA, could watch this game. So they have to change. And these guys, they've been chosen not because they're Tanzanian. We chose them because of the FIBA Africa international referees. So if they don't have that standard, then they must, you know, just change it, you know. So I think after the second half, they actually had the free. Do you know, you always have bad referee, you know, that is, you know, happens everywhere in the world, you know.
After the brief meeting, we couldn't watch the other semi-final game to find out who we were going to face in the finals. Seven of our main players were injured. You know, me and Wilwal took them straight to the hospital where we spent the whole night. You know, in basketball, you need your whole body intact if you want to be effective. And seven of our main guys, you know, were injured. You know, from all that aggressive games we were playing, you know, three of them had knee injuries. One had a back injury. Another one had a broken nose. One had a pulled hamstring. And the other one had, you know, groin injury. When we came back to the hotel in the morning, that's when we found out that we were going to play against Egypt in the finals. So we only had a few hours to sleep. I told everybody to go to sleep right away because the finals game is not something to take lightly.
We're going to the final.
I won. Somali toss of Al Gala, yeah? And I'll go in Mano in Bilaba. Somali toss of Scutisa.
basket kutoka mchezaji huyu jezi nambari 31 kutoka Kado, huyu ni Mohamed Mohamed mmoja.
After the final whistle was blown and Egypt won the game, while they were celebrating, that gave me a moment to think.
Come in.
Alright guys, tell me, what has been the secret to you guys' success in this tournament?
Teamwork and love will be telling you.
Teamwork and love will be telling
you. I'm trying to find it.
Before. Okay, guys, normal. You are one of the national team champ players from Egypt.
Yeah.
Tell me, have you had tough experiences in this? Is that what you're telling me?
Reflect on what we have done as a team since day one. I'm probably one of the few people that knew what we went through every single day and how challenging it was. Given the situation we were in, with not much support, you know, it gave me a lot to be proud of. We showed a lot of character. We went against the odds.
Our last game was pretty tough. Like, the Egyptian team was a team that has been training together for over 12 months. They live in the same facility. They train every single day. I think we had the lead in the first half. We were up about 4 points, 35-31. So it's what really matters is for us to put together a team that never trained together. Only had two practices in Tanzania, not even overseas, but in Tanzania. So it was impressive, you know?
I honestly thought before the game we were going to win the game. We have a lot of talented players, we have a good coaching staff. We just didn't put it together. The Egypt team was more experienced than us. They weren't better than us, talent-wise. We have better one-on-one players, we have better athleticism. They're more team. They had chemistry, they had flow, they had a coaching staff that had a strategy to beat us, and they executed every game. I did practice for 2 days. It was very tough. It was fun practicing and stuff, but I felt like if we had more time to practice together as a team, yeah, we probably have done a lot better and made it farther for sure. That
Somali basketball is on the rise. We're doing a good job. If we continue to keep funding the teams, we're soon to find success.
Oh, I don't think this team gelled together. We should have had a month training people from America and Canada to gel as a team.
There's a lot of locals that were supporting us, and they got to witness what we were doing. And it was very humbling to have grown people come up to you and, you know, want to take your pictures and giving you support, and that motivates you as a youth. And it's really motivating to see guys that are not too much older than us, you know, putting their time and their efforts into, you know, us to get better in basketball and to help our nation grow as one in terms of sports and athletics and basketball.
For me, it's my first time in Africa. So, mashallah, it's nice to see how this country is like and how people are living here.
It's been 2 days since we lost in the finals, and most of our players are in Zanzibar right now. We'll be right back.
There's a small Somali community living in Tanzania, and I can honestly say the love they showed us was unimaginable. We got a lot of love from them. They showed us a very good time. You know, they'll come to the hotel, take us out to eat, and you know, even though we had our own pocket money, they will not even let us pay for our own food. You know, a lot of our players got injured, and every time we go to a hospital, you know, they'll give us a ride. They will stay there for hours with us. You know, when we get charged, you know, the hospital fee, you know, they'll offer to pay. And you know, it's not something we were not asking for handouts, but you know, they were offering a lot of stuff to us, and I really appreciate it because you know, their support is what got us through, you know, all our games. Our victory is their victory. You know, we wouldn't have won those games without their support.
You know, I've been going around town in Dar Es-Salam, meeting different people, a lot of nice folks here. A lot of Somali people have businesses here, and they're all doing a good job. And I just had a chance to meet with the community leader, and his name is Mohammed Gugurte. The man is doing a heck of a job for our people here. You know, he's been telling me a lot of things. He's been working with a lot of people in terms of their immigration and stuff. He's been helping a lot of people start up their businesses. So I'm seeing a close Somali community here in Dar es-Salaam, which is similar to my community back home. You know, I'm starting to realize that Somali people are coming closer together nowadays. You know, we are not as divided as before, and I think sports has a lot to do with it.
The sports will unite Somalia in the way rugby united South Africa. In 1994, the Rugby World Cup in South Africa, when the South Africans won the rugby, the blacks and the whites, for the first time, they had a common team. Remember, rugby was only for the white population. The blacks were not the rugby players. But when the freedom, after the election and Mandela came to president, and we had some of the black players playing for the rugby, and for them to win the Rugby World Cup, it has actually unified the black and white in South Africa.
You see the competition, when people play, they don't say that Mogadishu is playing today, or they don't say that Qatar is playing today. They say Somalia are playing today, you know. And when we came to the finals, people were saying that Somalia versus Egypt. Nobody said Cairo versus Cairo. So that is the people that they should understand, you know, we are Somali. It doesn't matter where you come from, you know. At the end of the day, the name is Somali. I'm a member of the this committee. They see me as a Somali. You know, they say that we have one Somali from the committee. We have one of three from Somalia, Ahmed Dinaj. All that name carries in our flag. So,
but I believe that we cannot find support if we are not unit. That's the point. If you believe all what the Somalian believe, as clanism, as support each other for our region. But what's important for me is to become unit.
The team from Mogadishu, Somalia, who have you know, supported us and cheered us to all our victories. Amazing guys. I got a chance to meet all of them individually, including their director, Mr. Wish. And I'm really thankful that we got to meet those players from Mogadishu. You know, there's not too many chances where a team from America and Mogadishu meets, you know.
Yes, really, I see of them that they welcome us. That's the reason why we support them. Because when you came to Tanzania, they support, they welcome us. They try like a friends, even if we don't know each other. So that's why we support them. Not also the second reason is because we are Somalian, but the first reason because they welcome us.
waxa wada waxa kamid ah dhalinyaray Thailand ah soo baxay oo kamid yahay Ahmed Yasiin kamid yahay oo macallimiinta hore ay kamid yihiin waxa Mareykanka jooga oo dhan waxay isku mashquulayaan si ay ciyaartay u soo saartaa waan la taaban karaa maanta shalayna waan la taaban karaa inay yihiin soo saareen booskoodii wax bedeli kara final Soomaali kubiga xitaa doornimada ka jirtay final la soo gaaray koox socota waa markii ugu horeysay
Tanzania is a good place it's a place where I feel like you know I can come maybe once a year or every other year you know come here and just get away from all that hard work and stress from back home you know this is I think is a good vacation spot. Their English translation is not the same as our English translation they will take words literally. Sometimes in America or you know Canada, we like to speak in metaphors. For instance, you order food. Like one day, I ordered a cheeseburger, and I'll never forget that day.
Like earlier, I ordered a cheeseburger. And this man brought me literally, you know, a bun and a cheese. No meat inside. You know, I thought that was crazy, man. So I had to return the order. Now he's gonna bring me a cheeseburger with a meat inside it this time.
The man of meat, the order was different. You wanna say you need cheeseburger?
Cheeseburger. Okay. Yeah.
So now, cheese. You got me the right order, right?
Yeah.
Now I have a cheeseburger, right?
Everything you say.
Oh okay. My God! Thank you. I ate the fries earlier. Tastes nice. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Appreciate.
After I came back home, it gave me a chance to connect back with my kids and my family. And you know I had to pick up where I left off as far as going back to work and stuff like that. I've been here for 5 days when I started feeling you know nauseated. I started throwing up, fever came over me. You know I told my wife that I'm coming down with something. I had to rush to the emergency room to find out what was really going on with me, and after they ran some tests they found out they had malaria. You know, that really shocked me because up until that time, I hadn't even realized that, you know, I didn't vaccinate myself. Here I am calling all the players every day, you know, making sure all of them were vaccinated and so we wouldn't contract malaria. You know, I forgot to vaccinate myself. You know, it really put my life in jeopardy, and you know, I wouldn't advise anybody to do that. But it happened to me, you know, because I was going through so much that I even forgot about, you know, taking care of my health. I stayed in the hospital for 5 nights, which was 5 hard nights. So 2 players were diagnosed with malaria. This stuff is not easy. We don't wish it on anybody, you know. The funny thing is, you know, a nurse that was, you know, helping me asked me where I got the malaria from, and I told her I got it from Tanzania. And, you know, she heard about how, you know, nice and how beautiful Tanzania is. She asked me, you know, I remember she asked me, was it worth it? And I looked at her dead in the eye, and I told her every minute of it.
fikirta naftay ma fi hay chelani chaayl ku hayay chawigu ka huye chikarta naftay ma fi hay chelani chaayl ku hayay chawigu ka huye chikarta naftay ma fi hay chelani chaayl ku hayay chawigu ka huye chikarta naftay Just stay.